Today's scripture comes from Ephesians. It's chapter 5, verse 8 through 14. For you were once in darkness, but now you are in the light of the Lord. Live as children of the light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything is that is illuminated becomes a light. That is why it is said, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine upon you." This is the word of God for the people of God. I have a greater respect for Pastor Carrie and Doug. I was picking up Stanley at 7:15 this morning. So Stanley and I have put in a morning. We've been talking about lasting values, the things that are most important in our lives. Pastor Carrie had spoke on truth, and then he spoke on hope. Today I'm going to speak on grace. Paul's description of grace that won't let go. The light in my message represents grace. Shine your light with grace. I wanted to open with more scripture because this is very important to me. Because of his great love for us, God gives us mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raises us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Jesus Christ. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourself, it is a gift of God. I got to open with a little funny, not funny to me, but you know how it is when you're married and your spouse knows what you're going to say, or, you know, they can end your sentence and you can theirs. You're a team. You do everything together. You share with them. I have known about this for months and literally have prayed about it and worked on it and everything. And, you know, my husband and I worship together every Sunday at first service, and He says to me, he says, "Kim, now you realize you got to speak on grace." And I said, "I know, honey. Carrie told me months ago." But he was just trying to help, like they always do. He's making sure I got the message. So here we go. The other morning I was getting ready to babysit my grandchildren. I drive to Westchester, so I leave very early, like 5:30, 6 o'clock. My corporate children go in early. I was picking out a pair of, like, sweatpants, black sweatpants, and I realized it was cold outside. So I went to my closet to get a matching jacket, stood there several minutes to see if it was a dark blue or dark black. Before the thought struck me, I almost shouted, "Silly, go to the light." I work a lot in the dark because I don't want to wake up my husband and dog when I leave. Things are so much clearer in the light. Things are so much easier to accomplish in the light. Anyone who has tried to walk across a room in the night and tripped over something along the way will attest to the principle: light makes all the difference. It is no wonder that the biblical witness light figures so prominently. Genesis begins with the advent of light, the first thing made. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Light where there first to be warm and nurture, to guide and comfort, for us to extend, to be called into being, the light has to be present. The prophet Isaiah offers words of hope for the people of the days, words that announce a new day and an offer of promise. Arise, your light has come. It was hope for their day and the foretelling of hope for all people for the coming of the Messiah. The Gospel of John does not tell the story of Christmas, recalling a baby boy or a wise man on a trip. John will begin with light. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. It is important that we spend a few minutes considering this matter of light. For if we are like shepherds and wise men who follow light to find the gift from God, we too must discover the value of light for this our journey towards remembering. To think about light is to also think about darkness. In darkness, there is confusion. In darkness, there is question. In darkness, things are not so clear. In darkness, we hide those things which in light we would not do. Light often puts us in places of darkness, no matter how much we believe or how sure we are about God and God's love. There is darkness of illness and grief. There's darkness of pain and sorrow. There's darkness of betrayal and fear. There is darkness of a bad economy, of lives too hurried for our own good. The darkness of family issues and problems. The darkness of our own arrogance and denial of our own place in issues. My list could go on. We have trouble seeing clearly in dark times and places. One thing looks remarkably like another. Things appear that cause us to stumble and even to fall. Sometimes we fall into darkness in life, and other times we choose to go there. Either way, darkness breeds a kind of desperation and hopelessness. In those times of darkness, we need to hear, "Silly, go to the light of grace. Arise, shine, your light has come. The light shines in the darkness, and it is not overcome." As simple as it sounds, it is not easy as heading towards a window in the outside brightness to check a color combination. In this time that should be filled with joy, it is more easy for us to be swallowed up in the darkness than to follow the light. How do we go towards the light of Bethlehem? How do we make it our own? Several things come to mind. Remember who you are and who you are and what the light has meant to you. When in darkness, go back to the basics. Pick up the Bible. Read it again. Those passages which have meant a great deal to you. Watch for the light they will shed on your life. When in darkness, move close to those whose light is bright. For those friends and family whose switches are on, their light can guide and encourage you. When in darkness, open yourself to God in a new way. Pray in silence and in trust. Claim the promise of Isaiah, "Arise, shine, your light has come." The scripture doesn't say it is coming or it is promised to come. It says it has come. Claim the promise, the light has come. We have received Christmas. We have received a child born to us. The gift is already given. Claim the promise. You are in the dark. Your light has come. Follow it. Follow it running if you must towards a stable and a child. As a great gift as God's light can be to our life, being the light of God's presence to another is what God asked you to do. The joy of God's gift to us is that we enable to take on the light and be the light in all kinds of dark places. The children in our church sing and ring bells, "I'm gonna let it shine." Those who follow the light of Christ are enabled to make part of that light. During this season of preparation and remembrance, find the ways you can let your light shine. Shine in a spirit of gratitude. This week, unfortunately, a neighbor of mine right next door, I'll get emotional. Her son passed away at 54 of cancer, and he left two college-age twin boys and a wife. And Pat and Ron lost their other son years ago when he was 28 years old of cancer. So just being there for my neighbor, it was so tough. But just being there for her. So I purchased a huge mom, this big, Wolfangle, paid a fortune for it, worth every penny. And I could spend the neighbor's money. And I purchased a sweet angel this big, and it was a male angel, and he was praying. And she called me right away, and she said, "I know who did that." You know, so just those sweet things, it means a lot to people. I know it is the season of gifts, and you can probably get already tired of that work. I challenge you to give a gift that is not required, and that is not for those you love. Give a gift to someone who truly needs to have light shine in their lives. Food for the hungry, books for those who have none, blankets for people that are cold, live outside, coats for the weary, encouragement for the disillusioned. Don't worry about if they're deserving. Simply do your work and do good. It is light giving to another, to yourself. Shine in a spirit of noticing. Notice someone this season who has fallen between the cracks. Notice a child who needs some extra attention. Notice a family member who is in trouble or afraid. Notice your enemy as a person apart from your argument. Notice the people around you and let them know you have seen them. Notice your world. Find the beauty of your surroundings and breath. Your light shines in every breeze that blows, every tree that lives, every bush that calls bloom. They are angels who have words for you and your light, and light your life all around. But you have to notice them. Go to the light. Shine in a spirit of preparation. Do not let this time of preparation go by without time of prayer and for recalling the great story of God's love. Do not let this time go by without watching for the light and being the light to another. Arise, shine, your light has come. You have seen it, you live in it, rejoice. I had to share one more thing to close. Pastor Carrie's always got a mug or a shirt, or so I have my costume. You might recognize it. Last year, I wore it in the musical. Think about where we were last year. It's the same. Truth, hope, grace. Shine your light with grace that is given to you. To close the Wednesday morning Bible study, Diane Morris came up with these bookmarks. And what I want you to do is I want you to remember this Sunday and what the message was. And it says, God's riches at Christ's expense and that's grace. For by the grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. May God be with you with grace.